dispositional alignment. They are more restless in posture and demeanor, more neural. At the same time, they seem blanker, shallower than their predecessors. The extent to which they are cut off from the past, from an encompassing sense of history, is startling. They are appallingly without the kinds of context required for any significant exchange of ideas. They lack the means, the language. They lack a working knowledge of ideas and philosophies. They have lost the feeling for language as a living, supple, delighting, generative entity. No fiddling with curricula is going to restore these things. The main source of the trouble is the loss of the habit of reading. Almost none of my students, says Birkertz, read independently. Not reading for school, not beach reading, but the serious, private, self-generated interaction with books that forms the main path toward inner cultivation. For reading is stillness, absorption, the forging and sustaining of mental perspectives. It is active, difficult. It opens upon density and diversity. And it is also listening to voices, rhythms, articulations of otherness. To read is to situate oneself in some relation to a heritage. Reading keeps the language alive in us. Not just words and their uses, but a feeling for the syntactic masonry required by different kinds of expression. Will the world be different if people stop reading? Very likely, it will again be flat. Birkert goes on and says, one cannot write well if one does not read. Writing is more than just the transmission of ideas or information. Effective, memorable writing depends on the writer hearing the language. And reading develops that auditory awareness. One balances sounds, their values and meanings. If you can't hear words and their arrangements, the music that accompanies and enforces meaning, then you can't write. Certainly not well. That feeling or sense for language is more than the grasp of its vocabulary, grammar, syntax. Whatever the language, Tagalog or English, the sense for language is the basic poetic sense, an imaginative grasp of words and their sounds, a sense for their cultural weight, an instinct for order, wholeness, intelligibility. The university has the most fundamental responsibility for language. For what I propose, I am sorry, passing a language proficiency test before a student is allowed to graduate. Such a requirement at the undergraduate level stresses a student's responsibility to foster through all his years in college. Such mastery of the language as would enable him to express with ease and even with felicity his thoughts and feelings on topics that he is knowledgeable about. The language that I have chiefly in mind is, of course, the global language called English. We all know that proficiency in any language is unremittingly enhanced and enriched through reading. So I propose to be distributed at the annual freshman convocation a reading list of 100 books, the classic works in literature, philosophy, religion, the social and natural sciences. This will constitute the very heart of their general education. Throughout the academic year, there should be a series of lectures by our scholars and a number of books in that list to which our students may repair for intellectual refreshment. I find it significant that the student organization in the College of Arts and Letters in UP Diliman calls itself Read or Die. But I have gone ahead of myself. I want to dwell on the nature of language and the nature of a literary work. I said earlier that the sense for language is the basic poetic sense, because language is already work of imagination. Any natural language is already a translation of reality. The word translation comes from Latin transferi translatus, meaning to carry or ferry across. Thus, when we write, we ferry across the world our perceptions of reality. Across the ever-changing river of lexical meanings, we bear our words without hurt. The meanings of our words do not come so much from the words themselves, from their differential relations, but from lives lived. If the grape is made of wine, says Eduardo Galeano, then perhaps we are the words that tell who we are. This is why when we read a poem or a story, we need to imagine the human action, the human experience that is represented or simulated there. Language makes real the mind to our consciousness, our perceptions of reality. For it is the mind that has the imaginative power. When the imagination sleeps, says the philosopher Albert Camus, words are emptied of their meaning. In that sense, what is most imagined is what is most real. Moreover, if the sense for language is intimately bound with one's sense of reality, then in a profound way, language creates our reality. That is the essential power of language. All great writers work from, forge from a given natural language, their perception or interpretation of reality. Indeed, they create their subject as a clearing in the vast field of human understanding. That clearing is constituted not only by the matter, but also by the manner or style of writing. As Camus says, style is the simultaneous existence of reality and the mind that gives reality its form. I am a professor of literature, and so my bias is decidedly for the literary work. All writings deal with human experience and are limited by it, for we can observe and apprehend only as human beings. All writings are, before anything else, work of language and work of imagination, both. And only by that way might every kind of writing move toward becoming a work of art. Work is the key word, the work of forgery, in the triple sense of the word, to forge, that is, to form or fashion, to feign or fabricate, to forge ahead or advance. It is quite significant that poetry is associated with verse. The word comes from Latin versus, which means furrows, those cuts in the earth made by the plow. Thus, as the farmer works the soil to produce his crop, so the poet works his language to produce his poems. I take the figure of the poet as a figure for all writers, because all writing aspires to the condition of poetry. Poetry enables language to transcend its limits by its evocative power. Similarly, the word text is from Latin textus texere, meaning to weave, so that to write is to plait or braid together the sounds and the words of a language. Now, what distinguishes the literary work from other kinds of writing is the singular fact that it seeks to fashion, feign or mimic an individual experience, to relive, to give its representation a human face. That imaginative fashioning or feigning is what used to be called by the Greek word mimesis, from which comes the English mime, mimicry, the act of feigning or simulating. Mimesis, then, is the creative process of imagining whereby a form is imposed upon the artist's material. That material, as regards the literary arts, is language and human experience. The etymology of the English word experience is very illuminating if we bear in mind that what distinguishes the literary work from other forms of writing is its mime or simulation of a human experience as imagined, as lived. The Greek word for experience is empeireia, from the verb empeiran, to try or attempt, and also peran, to go or pass through, to undergo. Thus we have the English word empirica. But the Greek vocabulary passes to Latin experire, to try or attempt, from which the English words experience and experiment derive. Moreover, the Latin experire relates to Latin periculum, which means both attempt and danger. Such is the meaningfulness of that word experience. It is associated with faring, going on a journey with peril and fear. One goes forth and is tried. One meets with chance and danger, and nothing is certain. In the literary work, it is that human experience, as imagined, as lived, by which we are moved as we read. That is the essential power of a literary work. It gives us the very sensation of living. It gives us a vivid sense of our humanity. Without a masterful use of language, no literary work can rise to the level of art. Now, form is the matter of art. Content, the matter of interpretation. We said earlier, creative writing is the process of imagining by which a form or structure is imposed on the writer's material. That form is the very form of the human experience that has been mined or simulated by a particular deployment of language. For the writer, poem or short story is only a convenient label. When they write, they do not adhere to any fixed criteria or theory of the literary work. They only aspire to creating something unique in their playing field, which is the field of imagination. They make things anew, or they make new things. Form is achieved content, says the critic Mark Schurer. When Jose Dalizay was asked whether his stories were true, he said, yes, of course, because on the page where the story is the life that matters. That life, as imagined, as lived, is achieved by the story's form. In Horace's critical dictum, dulce et utile, delightful and